First split that he missed out on playing in the LSPL, and then Fly, we didn't mention him, of course, their Korean mid laner. Previously played for the Jin-Air Stealth, so has OGN experience in previous years. So when it comes to a final, when it comes to this big best of five for your playoff life, you need those experienced players to really help the other ones just get through what could be a really tough series, both mentally and just in terms of preparation.
Well, of course, YG coming into arguably one of the most difficult matchups here in the promotion tournament, but the bans are coming through. Nautilus going to hit the bench as well as the Rumble here. Profit not going to hop on that champion. His last couple of games, of course, played on that one. And Gragas and Thresh taken away here from Zero.
I mean, well, really interesting to see what priority there is on this Hecarim pick. Just because we've seen Teleport Smite Hecarim completely wrecking the life of hyper carries in particular without big repositioning skills. And Name loves to play that Jinx, loves to go for the big damage threat from the backline. So leaving Hecarim up for Profit, I don't know if I'd do that for Star Horn Royal Cup, but they do have first pick. And those champions, the likes of Shyvana and Hecarim with Smite, have been very popular in recent weeks.
Yeah, and the Aurelia, of course, 100% win rate there for Profit. Not going to get a look at here as well. And of course, Kola comes in a very confident top laner against a lot of these LSPL teams, but he's going to go straight ahead and snap up that Hecarim. Of course, more than happy to play it, and he picks it away from Profit as
I talked about the Hecarim. It does seem to be the favorite pick just because, again, if you get the big trio of items for Hecarim, which evolved into the Skirmisher Saber with the challenging Smite, into the Homeguard Boots and the Trinity Force, you can either instantly kill the enemy AD carry or burst him out to the point, push him to the back of the fight, and just take reduced damage with the challenging Smite. You deal with hyper carries so well. It's just really evolved into a popular first pick. As Young Glory seem to be going a little bit very meta with these picks, the Nunu priority that we've seen in the last two LPL playoff finals, and now the Lulu.
Yeah, the Lulu being locked in. It looks almost like it could be going towards something like that Juggernaut comp that we have seen be rather successful. But how does that go at the current patch? Because we haven't seen that much of it.
It's still very strong, but Hecarim's actually one of the best tools to deal with it, just because he can isolate out that carry in the back line and really take it out. You can see the Star Horn Royal Cup, they're kind of smelling the same thing you're smelling. They're smelling the Protect the Carry comp and go for Kennen and Urgot, probably going to be a bottom lane, given that we've seen so much a support Kennen in recent weeks.
Yeah, well, it's true, but it could be going anyway here.
Sure.
We haven't really realized the fact that Insec is on this lineup now, loves the jungle Hecarim.
I don't think we'll be seeing the jungle Hecarim, but you're right, it is a possibility. Yeah. It has been played at the highest level competitive play in China by Insec of all people. Comfort on his way back to the lineup. I don't know if it's about the Comfort Hecarim jungle, but it's possible.
Yeah, it could happen. You never know here in the LPL or LSPL here as we move into this promo tournament. But it is going to be the Jinx, the hyper carry picked away from Name here. Of course, had already locked in that Urgot, but going to guarantee an AD carry Urgot there. Is Khorne thinking about an Orianna? Of course, a massive Comfort pick of old here for Khorne, potentially, if they lock that one in. But Janna here for Yancer, and that's going to be a very AD-centric comp.
But you look at the Star Hong Royal Cup lineup, there's so many viable ball carriers, four bad ball carriers. If they stick with the Jarvan, Urgot will swap himself into the middle of the fight. Kennen can use that ultimate, the Slicing Maelstrom, defensively. But in this particular lineup, where you only have one threat you need to lock down, we'll probably be diving in. Hecarim with the Onslaught of Shadows, the Flag and Drag into the Cataclysm from Jarvan. If Khorne gets going in the laning phase, if they don't pressure objectives and you just get to a 3-4 item Orianna, you can see that the ball carriers will be very predictable, but there's only one threat at this present point that you need to kill in this YG lineup. It's Chushui on the Jinx.
You have to remember the best ball carrier in the game, which is Urgot, who swaps himself into the enemy team and then blows people around.
Yeah, I mentioned that. It's a very clear one. The suppression very reliable. With all this frontline dive, they're thinking of going for another backline champion. Star Horn Royal Club, if they do see this Xerath locked in, their goal is to take down the outer ring of turrets, push the aggressive wards down, and go for the flanks. Because this is a lineup that can be really flanked down by any of these members. Even Urgot showing around the back for the swap might be enough to unsettle what is a very positionally focused YG comp.
Yeah, are they're going to have a lot of wave clear here on the side of YG, but are Royal Club going to be able to play around that? Because, of course, they've got lots of split pushing options as well.
It's dive versus kite. That's the exciting thing, is that both teams have very clear win conditions. Star Horn Royal Club going straight in. It suits Insec. It suits the aggressive play style of even Zero, who really has been favoring the Engage champions recently, and YG, they got the two big damage sets. They don't really have any semblance of initiation whatsoever. No. A Nunu Snowball as your most reliable initiation is never
not
a happy
so good
spot to be in. But they have so much kite back and disengage that if they can really hang around to the late game and get the ward supremacy, pink ward their flank, stop the flanking Hecarim, stop any teleport shenanigans, they have a good chance to win this game.
Yeah, and Prophet actually going to be on that top Lulu, of course, as it shakes out against the Hecarim. Insect going to be taking the Jarvan against the Nunu, of course, a matchup of a few patches past here, but still very, very strong. And Khorne, the wave clear mid lane, probably not too much action to go on early.
I'm hoping we see really big jungle action. Beast, of course, catapulted onto the scene, playing that Nunu into Jarvan and winning the matchup, getting aggressive in the face. If I know anything about Illusion, aggression is on the table.
That is definitely what's going to be happening here. But the classic matchup, the classic counter matchup here of Janna and Kennen in the bottom lane, not exactly what we're used to seeing as far as support is concerned, but Kennen always had a bit of trouble here trying to slicingly Maelstrom his way around when there's that Monsoon ready.
But the thing about slicing Maelstrom versus Janna, if you're talking about a carry Kennen, absolutely, Janna completely undoes any sort of initiation threat from Kennen. But the flexibility of support Kennen is that you can just fight around your carry, just use that ultimate for peel. I mean, Kennen with a hyper carry has always been one of my favorite champion kind of synergies, because you just pop that ult, no one can dive your hyper carry, and you just put out damage during all that CC that Kennen's kit provides.
Yeah, and it was largely why he was good as an AD carry himself. But ladies and gentlemen, let's get on to the Rift. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, game one between Sahorn Royal Club and Young Glory. Zero already going to find Prophet putting down some deep wards here, scouting out a potential lane swap. And of course, they've seen the support, so they may know that something's up and we're going to have some bottom lanes here for Sahorn Royal Club.
So it's really emerged that teams that have this Hecarim want to force the lane swap, even if they have favorable 2v2 matchups. You'd expect Urgot Kennen will be happy to opt to a laning matchup against the Jinx. Of course, Jinx's range not that big until she gets a couple of levels into her rockets. Janna doesn't provide any sustain. You think, okay, Sahorn Royal Club 2v2, scouting out the 2v2. But what's actually emerged, specifically EDG during this Atlas, is that they want to lane swap with the Hecarim just because most teams are freezing. Most teams aren't pushing in the wave. So with a smite, your jungle follow and just your ability to leave lane and pick up camps is much higher than a regular Hecarim would say teleport ignite. So you can pick up so many camps in the lane swap that by the time you're actually made accountable, that by the time that things are pushing, you'll just have more items than the traditional Hecarim as a 375 range champion. 350 range with Rampage usually struggles in any semblance of a lane swap. But when you can exit the lane and smite, much easier.
Yeah, well, you can see starting both sides of the Royal Club jungle here are the top laner and the jungler, but it is going to be standard lanes erupting here. Of course, Royal Club probably still going to be okay with it because you mentioned before that Urgot a bit of a lane bully here come level 2 or 3, but range advantage might be there in the first level because, of course, lacks a bit of wave clip.
Absolutely. At level 1, if you're forcing Name to use that mana for kind of pruning the wave, just auto-attacking these minions and throwing acid hunters at the minions, you're doing your job because, of course, getting the mana low means that Urgot just won't have as much harass if he hits that Noxian Corrosive Charge from level 2 onwards.
And one thing that's difficult here for Chu Shui as well on this Jinx is the fact that Name is probably one of the most successful Jinx players and knows exactly how that champion moves.
He's on the Urgot, not necessarily one of his comfort picks, hasn't played a lot of Urgot in competitive, so it's something different from him, and it's going to require a kind of a team effort for damage in the late stages. Hecarim, of course, does a lot of damage if he's able to get to that Trinity Forge Skirmisher's Saber. Orianna can do a lot of damage, but we've seen plenty of Orianna's fall behind in the LPL. The aggressive trading continues, but Name very low on mana.
Yeah, it does have that Flask start, of course. There's also a Mana Potion there as well, but the Eye of the Storm shields are helping out here from Yancer, but still, YG getting pushed out of this bottom lane so far.
I like the Kennen with Urgot just because, okay, Urgot doesn't have a lot of lane presence levels 1 to 2, but you know who does? It's this Kennen. Level 1 with the poke, no resource poke into level 2. Just getting another guaranteed CC potentially. And Name just using all his mana to try and establish lane control.
Yeah, actually, stun going to land there as well from Zero, who lands a nice combo. So Yancer actually forced to eat a biscuit and doesn't have any of those left either.
It's tracking the bottom lane. I guess it's been farm lanes in the other lanes, which of course suits the Hecarim, you'd have to say, in top. He's 6 CS behind, but not a big issue.
Yeah, of course, it's always going to be the case, this melee range matchup, and Lulu being a bit of a lane bully herself, but probably not going to be able to sufficiently keep down this horse.
I mean, Hecarim, we talked about the fact that their teams have been kind of just having to lane swap their Hecarim just to try and find him fine because he struggles in a lot of 1v1 matchups. He's actually being able to get through this Lulu matchup just fine. He's gone for the heavy regen start with the flask and the potion. It's just more than what we expect. They're looking to Name to win this 2v2 rather than trying to set up Cola for a big late game spike.
Well, you can see already Illusion and Insect spotting each other out. The Ice Blast is going to land, but Illusion, you have to follow him around here. Doesn't have boots, but that Blood Boil helping him move through this jungle quite effectively. But the collapse might be coming through here from the mid lane, but Insect is going to safely make it back to his jungle. As my goodness, Chushui going down very, very low. Name, though, it could be in trouble. Gets exhausted. The heal's been blown already. Zero, he picks up first blood. Lightning rushes out of there as well, and he's going to be safe. Beautifully played by the support player.
Yeah, so held onto the flash for a long time. Did Name bought enough space, and then Zero is the one that gets the aggressive first blood. Excellent play for him. The last auto's had just enough damage, and Chushui pays for what has been a very punishing laning phase so far. Name just used every bit of mana, literally has no mana regen left, used all his flask and the mana potion, and they pick up the kill.
My goodness, and Chushui actually forced to buy that Avarice Blade as well, so already playing from so far behind.
I mean, whenever you're in a 2v2 against an Urgot Cannonlade, you're expecting to have minimal lane presence, but opting into an Avarice Blade, you're just doubling down the fact that you expect Urgot to start freezing this lane, honestly, when it starts moving towards this turret. Just because in terms of 1v1 trading, even though Urgot's opting into a tier, the base damage is so high on those Acid Hunters that Chushui's going to find it very hard to pick up farm.
Yeah, and actually Name picking up a Cloth Armor very early here. Has to be going towards that Glacial Shroud, you might think, but see what he does decide to pick up. And you are definitely one to converse about the cooldown reduction necessities here for Urgot.
I mean, Glacial Shroud just fits.
Oh my goodness, there's the Shockwave though. Zero's coming through. Only level 4, of course, doesn't have the ult, but Insect, he's coming around, forces the flash. EQ doesn't get the knock-up. They're trying to dive, but Insect not quite able to get that last couple of auto attacks and fly. Uses both summoners, but does survive.
You're trading flash for flash, though, mid for jungle. You'll take the jungle flash, and Chushu hits lane, Noxian Corrosive Charge hits, and he's got half health.
Yep, and Name able to pressure him all the way out of this lane.
The freeze coming through, though, Atlas. Able to hold this wave so happily. Gonna find it so hard to enter lane. Jinx already farming again. Goes back for the boots. Would prefer to be skipping that and building up the AD, but no extra AD from items outside of the level 1 Doran Blade.
Yeah, and this lane isn't going anywhere here. Name able to even free hit some backline minions, but still hold it just outside this turret, and that is awful news here for Young Glory.
And this is what was going to develop if you couldn't go back and shop for, say, a pickaxe or, you know, preferably the BF. So if you can't look to trade with Urgot, Urgot can use that mana defensively when he has both a tier and the flask for some extra mana regen. And this is just excellent lane control coming from Name. And this, remember, is a Young Glory comp. It's a two-threat comp, really looking to empower Chushui in the late game. And Chushui's laning phase is already looking horrible. He's half the CS of Urgot.
Yeah, does this sort of fit Young Glory's playstyle, who often play around their solo laners?
I mean, the big thing to consider is that regardless of their previous playstyle, this is definitely a build-up the Jinx comp between the Nunu and the Janna, who really want to fight around them. Both Fly and Chushui are going to need to be relevant in the late game because it's a very tanky lineup coming forward from Starholm Royal Cup. And if they're able to just exclusively itemize for magic resist and kill the Jinx because she's behind or they don't have to respect her damage, the comp just falls apart.
Yeah, and Illusion as well, of course, on the Nunu, is farming up relatively well around this jungle, but hasn't made his presence all that known. Not quite the Illusion of old that we remember being overly aggressive so far in this game, but might be just looking to get a few levels and then start to impact the map. Does have level 6, so that absolute zero is there, and we'll see where he decides to opt into next.
You have to feel if Illusion wants to go aggressive, it's going to be on the top side of the map just because the 2v2 lane is already in panic stations. Can't really impact this lane. Nunu is certainly not going to be the ganking champion to open up Chushui getting a bit of lane control, in the bottom lane. In the top of the map, though, with the fact that Lulu's always going to have the pushing advantage over Hecarim, get in the face of the blue buff. You know, start contesting for this enemy blue buff. Xerath does have pushing options against Orianna, especially in early levels, and that's maybe the area where Illusion can look to do a bit of counter jungle, because for now, as you mentioned, it's been anchored to his own camps.
Yeah, although his own camps are actually getting stolen away by his team here as Chushui and Yanzi are actually heading up towards that Gromp to take that away just to get any semblance of gold here. As Name, he's got a 46 CS advantage there in that bottom side of the map, just freely stacking that tier up. And this gold lead, oh my goodness, there's the Cataclysm to come through as well. Oh my goodness, the easy command protect into the Shockwave tries to get the right of the Arcane off, but Khorne picks up an easy kill there in the mid lane, and Insect, he's happy to be back.
It's an excellent wraparound gank, of course, because they had exact timer of Xerath's flash, because they traded flashes, Insect and Fly in the previous engage, knew it wasn't up. Shockwave comes up available, even was able to leave the kill credit over to Khorne. So confident was he in that last 100 damage being accounted for, and Orianna gets going.
Yeah, and Khorne able to pick up a blue buff for himself as well prior to that, so he's going to be more than happy in this lane, almost has the chalice completed. Well, actually has the chalice, is going towards the extra items, and he's actually completed now as well.
He's just looking really, really strong in the bottom lane as well. The CS load keeps going, still over double, 84 to 41.
It's terrifying here for the Jinx, but of course probably wants to be scaling through later, might be able to find some side lane farm once some of these turrets go down, maybe trying to find some sort of good news story here for Young Glory, but it's very difficult when Name and Zero have been putting on so much pressure down in this lane. And now Name's going to go back, and you have to think that could be a Manamune already.
And the lane's already pushing in his advantage still. That's why he's happy to go back in this situation. Zero's going to sit an ultra last hit if he gets the option to. But the bottom lane, as you mentioned, Manamune is now completed. Zero can go back, probably pick up mobility boots. He's not even needed in the bottom lane. They have to respect Urgot just by himself. So the roaming might start from the cannon. Has level 6. Has the Sorcerer's Shoes actually. It's gone for the even more expensive boots.
Suddenly, those
ganks with the Slicing Maelstrom are looking pretty formidable.
Yeah, and that early game damage spike as well, because of course, once you've got the Slicing Maelstrom, does do a lot of extra damage now that you've got that magic penetration, and does help for sort of just an early spike in power. So I really like it, because this is what Zero does. He moves around the map, and we saw him ganking the mid lane before, got both of the summoners, but now even has a stun more readily available.
And when we've seen him play the cannon, he's gone super aggressive with offensive items like the likes of the Zhonya's after the Sightstone. Might not need to be accountable for any sort of peeling. It's an Urgot anyway, so you don't necessarily need the Mikhail's. He's happy to dive the backline. We'll naturally build those tanky items like the Glacial Shard with that cloth armor eventually. So things just really looking good for Starhorn Royal Club.
Certainly looking up as Zero, looking for something down here. Doesn't find Jushui though, and Name continues the freeze.
You feel like Nunu just needs to come to this bottom lane and help them push, to be honest, Atlas, because the wave is consistently in a position where it's pushed for Young Glory. They can't even hit the minion line, because that opens up Noxian Corrosive Charge auto attack, and Acid Hunter's coming through from the Urgot. So they need this Nunu to provide a bit of lane presence. Ganking the lane at this point, the most successful gank they could ask for is just pushing in the wave.
Yeah, and Chushui trying to farm out with the zap, but doesn't quite find much. And Insect, he's more than happy to sit in the jungle of a Nunu here as well, who's forced to help out the bottom lane. Just going to head down here and throw in a Blood Boil onto Chushui, but does have a pickaxe now, so there's at least some flat damage built up for this Jinx.
Illusion's not willing to commit to actually pushing in the way of helping, you know, consume a couple of minions and fly. Does he have flash?
He certainly has to, but that's the Shockwave coming through, the teleport. Did threaten, so of course Royal Club are going to back away, but they get the summoner and they just trade some ults for it.
The big consideration was that Fly did have flash available. Jarvan would have known because his flash was available as well. The teleport's enough to buy time.
Yeah, it might mean some dragon pressure here as well, as Prophet looking for Cola doesn't quite find it.
Jinx is in the bottom lane, walking up to the cannon, level 6 cannon.
Oh, it looks for it. There's a Slicing Maelstrom as well. Forced to use the flash, but it's not going to be enough as Name picks up an easy kill delivered by Zero.
I mean, at this point, Young Glory need to do something about the bottom lane. Look for a lane swap, bring multiple members to help push it out. Illusion affecting the topside jungle of Starhorn Royal Club while Starhorn Royal Club are just picking up an uncontested dragon. Illusion needs to do something. It's not that easy on the Nunu, but he needs to make his impact felt, because this bot lane matchup, it cannot be sustained.
Certainly can't. Oh, blue buff, in fact, is still alive, as well as Royal Club are going to be able to go and steal that away, and they've started a shutout here on Young Glory. And Insect, you have to think that a lot of it has to do with the fact that Khorne and Insect have just been playing this mid lane so beautifully well. And after that bottom lane going so one-sided, which is what you oftentimes expect from the Urgot lane, there was not a lot that Young Glory could do about it.
A lot of this game was predictable from a Young Glory perspective. You know that your 2v2 matchup is going to be heavily in the disadvantage. You know that Name, one of the best AD carries in the world over the past few years, is going to be able to pressure out Chushui. So you expect that you have to comp around that, whether it's a lane swap, whether it's bringing Nunu in just for a bit of the laning phase action. Remember, in the years past, KT Bullets running Insect on Nasus and just walking down to bottom lane and pushing the lane in with the siphoning strike. You need to do something like that, because whenever Name starts the freeze, the CS lead just gets absurd. It's 73 CS between the marksmen.
It's just ridiculous at this stage of the game.
It's not going to get any better.
No, it's certainly not, although the wave has started to push back in, and that was a cannon creep just picked up by
Chushui. That was actually a mistake. Name has 2 points in the Terra capacity. Should have just tanked the damage from the zap and denied the cannon creep coming through. Probably just didn't consider it. A lock-on hits, and the damage results.
Yeah, maybe he just doesn't mind about it, because you can see already those acid hunters doing so much work. That was three lock-ons there, and that's
a fourth and an auto, and he would have been dead.
Just ridiculous. And Name only takes half of his health there. By shots from the turret, Yancer there as well. Another Noxian Corrosive Charge lands as Name just happy to tank up these turrets. Oh my goodness, that was so incredibly close. And Chushui has to go.
He falls into double-digit health from that last Acid Hunter. So good on him to be able to at least judge the damage, but this bot lane is a complete write-off. They need to play around it. At this point, they need to either start a lane swap or just look for advantages in other lanes, because having such a whitewash in bottom lane and nothing else necessarily going your way in any considerable advantage, they're losing mid lane from 20 CS. It's even in the top lane, but it's Lulu versus Hecarim. That definitely suits the Hecarim to be almost even CS with such a strong laning champion like Lulu. Young Glory getting outclassed in the first 15 minutes.
They are, and Insect as well, doing whatever he likes in this jungle. Not going to be shut out by the Nunu, who can often be quite a formidable counter-jungling opponent, but going to be starting up this blue buff here. Khorne going to be happily able to pick that one up. You can see there with the Command Protect on the way back. And the Orianna more than happy to scale up here. And this is the thing, Starhorn Royal Club, they're more than happy to sit in these lanes as well. They've got Hecarim, who scales beautifully. Orianna as well. I mean, you think Urgot might fall off just a little bit, but that's about all they need to worry about.
And Young Glory are a two-threat comp that really needs their Jinx to carry in the late game. Always going to be a difficult task against the Teleport Smite Hecarim. But a Teleport Smite Hecarim that's got basically free farm now has two cores of his three-item build. He has the Skirmisher Saber, Cinderhulk. He has the Homeguard enchant. When you're talking about the Jinx, she's lucky to have a pickaxe on top of the Avarice Blade and the Berserker Greaves. She's never going to hit a particularly relevant item spike and just dive the backline. Maybe even just focus the Xerath, stack magic resist, and it should be easy teamfight wins in the late game for Starhorn Royal Club.
Well, it looks like they're going for it at the moment. The mid lane under fire now is Khorne just going to throw a shield onto Little Zero. He's going to be A-okay. Of course, not talking about Zero size himself, but he is playing Cannon, who is rather small.
And he's going to keep going aggressive. Look at those items. He's got a Health Crystal and the Amp Tome. Probably going to be a Haunting Guise for a bit more early damage. And why not? He's not being pressured whatsoever. Isn't even needed in lane. Happily 1v2ing at this point is Name, although he's rotating around. They haven't got the best turret sieging team, that's for sure. But they're going to try.
Yeah, they're going to try. But trying against, I guess, the likes of the Glittalance and the Arcano Pulse coming through from Lulu and Xerath. It's very difficult to siege out this team, but the teleport's coming through behind Chushui, and he is in a whole lot of trouble. Kolo wants to pick up a kill, and it's like they're donating this Jinx around. Zero tanks up his damage, and Kolo gets delivered a kill.
And Zero had the slicing mushroom available, but didn't think it'd be necessary with the teleport coming through. Wanted to pass the kill credit over to the Hecarim, who now gets stronger and stronger. Gonna have the phage towards that Trinity Force. Item time is being hit earlier than part-time on Starhorn Royal Club, and just so far away if you're Chushui especially.
Yeah, almost has a static shift there completed, but I mean, it's sort of like the old Tristana situation where, oh, let's build a static shift so that we can be a little bit more relevant in the mid game, but it's not quite what you want when you're a Jinx. You want to have those rockets doing a lot of damage.
You don't have the same base magic damage that opened up the static shift rush on Tristana. You also have quite a lot of natural wave push yourself with the rocket form as well. So this is basically an emergency static shift. Lovely AD scale on her abilities, on the ultimate especially, but the AD looks a long way away.
Yeah, certainly is so far. 40 CS gap has actually built up now in the mid lane as well, as Luden's Echo looks to be the second item here for Korn.
We have seen this from Godveep, formerly Wayless on the LGD side. Loves to go for Luden's Echo Orianna. Of course, she moves around a lot between, wants to auto attack, so moves around in fights. And of course, her spells have very low cooldown, specifically that command attack has a very low cooldown, is the first ability max. So if you can get a couple of Luden's Echo procs out, it gives you basically instant wave clear with just the command attack and the dissonance. And then again, just more AoE damage in fights.
And you can charge it up relatively quickly, as you mentioned. Korn up here, now trying to clear out this top wave, going to deliver himself the ball here as well. 4-0 now with the kills, and a 6,000 gold lead has developed now at 19 minutes into this game. Royal Club definitely in control, and we'll see whether this Protect the Jinx comp can actually manage to work things out towards the later stages of this game. And
look, Atlas, it's not a Protect the Jinx comp at this point. She doesn't have the items to even require the protection. It's more
Nor is she getting any protection.
It's the Protect the Xerath comp in teamfights at best, and the Xerath's not exactly snowboarding himself either. So here comes a third out of turret, you'd have to think.
Yeah, it is going to be going down. Five members of Royal Club are here. Jinx able to get a little bit of a freeze there on the bottom side. Actually, no. It's pushing out that wave, so Chushui will have to overextend if he wants to pick up any creeps here at all. And Royal Club have started a bit of a strangulation here as far as the vision is concerned. And a second dragon now going down with no vision available at all by Young Glory.
And Nama is so strong, doubling down on the mid-game items. Mana Moon, Hex Drinker, and the Glacial Shard. Going to work towards the Frozen Heart. Nobody on this enemy team can duel the Urgot. And look at this, it is roaming around. And Chushui is overextended again.
Yeah, it does have heal and flash available. Nice use of the chomp as a zero nails in with a shuriken. They're starting to do a lot of damage now that dual magic penetration's come through. And they get the summoner spell, but they may as well just pass through that bottom lane on their way after dragon.
It's just very surprising they didn't get at least the flash. It was a pretty big mistake from Insect to just sit on the chops and allow them to trigger. Could have used Cataclysm, could have tried to use the EQ preemptively, tried to guarantee the kill and pass the kill credit over, but the result, no kill to pick up.
Yeah, not happening this time. But does go back and pick up an Aegis of the Legion here as well. Cola only about 1,200 gold away from that Trinity Force as well. You spoke about the Home Guards plus the Cinderhulk plus that Trinity Force, and that is going to be very, very soon for this Hecarim. Zap not going to find Name, just going to be there to try and clear out these creeps. Is Name able to get a little bit of extra damage down there into the back line and push this wave out? And now he's going to go back to buy, and we'll see what he picks up now. It might even be the Frozen Heart.
6,400 gold lead already at 21 minutes. It's looking like the perfect game, Atlas. No, it's not. I tell a lie. There is one turret down for Young Glory, but that's a very slim amount of hope left in this game. Hitting those item timings before the 40, 45 minute mark, when Jinx doesn't even have an Infinity Edge, not even close to Infinity Edge, maybe an Emergency Static Shiv at 22 minutes. It's not going to hit the item timings to have a two-threat comp. You need somebody ahead to buy time. And look, the Xerath, of course, will be able to provide a lot of wave clear, but it's only on Starhorn World Cup poorly rotating and not picking up advantages in the mid-game that Young Glory can hope to win. It's only Starhorn World Cup misfiring on their game plan.
Yeah, and Chushui actually has picked up a BF sword now, only about 1370 away from that Infinity Edge if he's going to finish that before the Static Shiv. Insect finds himself a red buff here as well, as Illusion does pick up aggro from that one. And Insect is a little bit overextended, but he's just going to leash that one out there for Chushui.
I mean, to give you an idea of gold values, as the flag seal almost comes through, Chushui is actually 600 gold behind Insect and the second lowest gold value on his team, with three supports especially, both the Nunu and Lulu, with more gold than the Jinx. The crown jewel of her comp right now, certainly far from that.
Yeah, not happening at the moment. See whether some side lane farm is going to be able to be picked up as Zero and Name are pushing in this bottom side. Chushui is, of course, there to try and pick this one up, but we'll see whether he gets dived under here. Of course, Hyperkinetic Position Reverser is available as Hallingale does fly through here as well. But even with the three members sitting under this turret, I'm still frightened for Young Glory at this stage.
With Nunu showing presence and already so much health from Illusion, they should be able to keep this turret up. The siege is not that wonderful, but this is the answer. There could be a potential Baron.
Yeah, Baron's going down very, very fast here at the same time. Glitterlance tries to steal it, but Insect, of course, he's got his finger on the smite, and they pick up a Baron so easily with three members. And Name just gets delivered Baron creeps.
Yeah, with the Baron buff now, with Baron minions, suddenly the 425 range Urgot is actually a potent sieger just because they can't look to compete with it. Hecarim now is so close to that call we've mentioned, probably has it on his next shot. So any sort of aggressive wards, and we could already see a scattering of blue wards in the red side jungle. If we ever see a flank, Hecarim's going to be able to instantly delete either Kyushu or Fly, and probably going to tend towards Fly this time because only his wave clear is buying time for Young Glory to turtle.
And we do have the Luden's Echo completed here by Khorne, now doing a whole lot of extra AoE damage. The Frozen Heart completed for Name. He has an extra pickaxe, of course, probably going towards that last Whisper there, but it, you know, might get a cheeky more of Malmortius.
Muramana transformed as well.
Oh yeah, it's terrifyingly strong. This is the item spike that you have with Urgot as well. This is the strongest your Urgot is going to be, and what a great time. They've just picked up the Baron, and now is when they need this Urgot to start making some plays, and he's looking strong.
It's a standard analytical point to talk about how Urgot very much peaks in the early game into the mid game. But I mean, that's accentuated further in this game because it's not one armor item completed on any of the members of Young Glory. Don't need to rush for that armor penetration, Atlas, barring maybe the flat pen from a Brutalizer, because there's no armor to shred.
Yeah, you may as well like lock through using the flat armor pen from the Brutalizer, but Name's not even too worried about it. Of course, now has a whole lot of defensive statistics. You can see already that this tower not doing a whole lot of damage to Name, and able to take down this inner turret very easily. These turrets are just falling systematically by Royal Club as the Zap does help clear out the wave here just a little bit. But you can see, look at how much tanking these melee creeps do.
And only Urgot in the mid is forcing multiple members to watch the turret, which of course means that the rotation to top is beautifully simple for Starhorn Royal Club. 6 turrets to 1, now 10,000 gold is the lead. And honestly, Starhorn Royal Club, they don't have the best siege, but they're going to start diving.
Yeah, they're going for something here as the Chompers come down zoning Name away just a little bit. But of course, a lot of creeps here as well. And you can see this Baroned up Siege minion more than happy to sit around for quite some time. Arcana Pulse comes through. Insect takes a lot of damage, actually, as Royal Club wait for the next wave. And Name able to get about half the damage off this turret here as well. So many shields to come down on this Urgot. As he dodges out of the way of the stun, Arcana Pulse comes through. Name very far forward as there's right of the Arcane. Oh my goodness, the hula hoop in the middle of the team. Not going to find anyone in his corn. And Royal Club, they are forced to back away. The wave clear comes out victorious.
It was a real big misfire from Khorne. Would have been much more threatening to just hold onto the shockwave rather than go for an opportunistic one. They were already winning that siege. They almost took down that outer turret, the inhibitor turret. They almost broke the base. One of the big win conditions against one of these multiple support duo or single threat comps is to break the base. They were on the cusp of doing that, but the misfire with the shockwave forces them to back away.
Yeah, it is still, of course, an 11,000 gold lead. Complete shutout here on the Dragon, the third one. The movement speed coming through right now here for Royal Club. Young Glory, Illusion is hanging around here. They do get a little bit of vision down, but then nothing they can do about this Dragon falling down. Royal Club, of course, they don't have the Baron buff anymore. And Young Glory have been able to push out these side lanes just a little bit, but Royal Club now just going to reset. Mora Malmortius was actually completed here by Name.
I mean, no rush for the last Whisper, so not a bad purchase whatsoever. Respecting the damage coming out from Fly, and then again, just the general magic damage from Nunu and Lulu. The only remaining win condition for Starhorn Royal Club is to break the base. They've basically locked down every other important objective on the map. There's strong wave clear. Lulu and Xerath is basically instant wave clear from the solo lanes. But going outside the base, this is where the problems start.
Yeah, Prophet might be in a little bit of trouble as Intek is prowling around his red side jungle. Yansa, though, of course, is here. Help him out with a bit of shielding, and Illusion able to give a blood boil as Fly picks up one of those. But Insect and Name just stealing away this red buff, taking whatever they want from the Young Glory jungle. Top lane under fire as well. Teleport available for Cola on this Hecarim is just relentlessly shoving through. And has so much wave clear as well. What with the Cinderhulk, the Rampage, now has an Elixir of Iron actually on himself. Does that increase the range of Cinderhulk?
It does not.
Oh, that's a bit sad.
There's just no good decisions for Young Glory, Atlas. Lulu can't stand up to the Hecarim with all these item timings. We've already seen that the 2v2 lane was landslide in the advantage of Starhorn Royal Club. Even though they don't have great siege, they're going to threaten the dive. Young Glory can think, okay, they can't flank us, but that's just because there's no structures for them to fight over.
Yeah, and they've got all of their wave clear now sitting up here in the top side. Cola tearing this turret apart. The Sheen procs from the Trinity Force definitely doing work. That's going to go down. And this inhibitor turret doesn't have a whole lot of health itself. And Name, lots of shields available as well. Khorne providing a lot of protection. Finally, Prophet heads towards that bottom side. This might mean the Royal Club want to pull the trigger. Nox and Corrosive Charge comes through, looking for someone. They don't quite find a pick, and we'll see exactly what happens here as it looks like Royal Club, they want to commit to this one. The tower's going to fall down. Insect flashes forward, doesn't get any knockoffs, but there's the absolute zero from Illusion. There's the shockwave we were looking for as Wild Growth lands, but just jumps right into our horse and gets shredded to death. Cola from the backside there, and all Insect needed was a Cataclysm.
And it's such a one-sided fight, but it's to be expected with the massive gold lead coming through from Starhorn Royal Club. There's just nothing working for Young Glory here whatsoever. They move towards this Juggamore-esque comp with the Protector Jinx, with the Zenith for long-range threat, but their tanks in the front line are weak. Their damage sources are very under-farmed. And even though the poke from Fly is quite good, they lost all their base at this point.
Yeah, all three inhibitors now down. Royal Club are going to bow out of this one, of course, running a little bit low on the old health and mana. They are going to head back, but you could say that this has definitely been successful so far, and they've got a Baron to pick up.
Khorne actually went back and bought another Needless Large item, has the death cap completed. So already, very early in this game, 29 minutes, happily sitting on 550 AP. The shield between the Terra Capacitator, which I believe has about a 500 base shield when you have Frozen Heart and a Miramana. And then now the shield's coming through from Orianna. On such a short cooldown, this Urgot suddenly has 3,000 effective health.
It's just ludicrous, and has now also picked himself up that Null Magic Mantle into the Negatron Cloak as well. I don't quite know what he's building towards. Could even be the Guardian Angel, maybe, but we may not even find out as 30 minutes into the game, 7-1, 12,000 gold the lead, no inhibitors available from Young Glory. Royal Club, they are looking to set up a trap here. There's the flag and drag through for Insect. The Shockwave not actually going to pop off just yet as the flash comes out by Illusion. Going to get himself to safety, but Royal Club now looking to try and put pressure back on this Baron, and the Super Creeps are going to overwhelm this base. It's just a matter of time before YG have to let this Baron go.
That's the thing. They can't even hope to contest because there's three waves of super minions pushing into their base. It was already going to be optimistic to try and contest for a steal. Not going to come through. Starhorn Royal Club going to get an unanswered Baron and then just look to finish this game.
Yeah, now it's time to deal with these Nexus turrets as well, and with Baroned up super minions attacking so quickly, it will be very, very difficult. What with Chushui as well, not a whole lot of wave clear now with only the Static Shiv Infinity Edge completed. Does have a cheeky longsword, but that is not quite enough here to deal with this one as the members of Royal Club come through with their super creeps. These Nexus turrets getting destroyed as well. Starhorn Royal Club with a dominating first game here in our first series of the day. Zero still wants some action, but the Nexus is going to fall down and Royal Club pick up game one.
Yeah, Royal Club rolled all over the LSPL team in game one. Definitely looking favorites to re-qualify based on that performance. They had clear win conditions, hit all of them, delayed all the power spikes from Young Glory, and crucially, Young Glory with a two threat comp, with a 2v2 lane that on paper was going to lose, in practice definitely lost, just had no answers to try and get them back in the game or force a massive advantage in other lanes. They either need to compensate for the losing lane or try and attack it and open it up, and they did neither.
Yeah, and maybe it might be something to do with taking away the Urgot option here for Name, some of the other priority picks to be taken away from Starhorn Royal Club, but we'll see what Young Glory do, because of course there is more games to come, ladies and gentlemen. Young Glory not out of this one yet, and we'll see you just after this break.